Oh, hey, I didn't see you there. Hey everybody, Gareth Foley here with FCP Euro, and today we're going to take you through the steps on how to replace a leaky oil filter housing gasket on a 535 XI. This process, of course, is going to be similar across all the N5X series of engines, so your N51, your N52, N54 and N55, the N54 and the N55 being the most difficult because it requires intake manifold removal. Obviously on the N51, N52, you can get away without having to do that, but enough talking, let's get started. So like I said, we're doing this repair on an N54, which is going to be the most challenging, while also on the N55, because you do have to remove the intake manifold. In order to do that, you have to take the cowl cover off the engine, you have to remove your air filter housings, you have to do a whole bunch of additional work that's not going to be required if you have an N51 or an N52 engine. So if you don't have those engines, you can go ahead and skip towards the part where we start taking things apart. But the layout of this car is going to be the most difficult compared to a lot of the other vehicles that you might be doing this job for. You can see we have a lot of oil residue, and I suspect as we start peeling away layers of this onion, you're going to start seeing oil residue down the front timing cover. And the problem on these engines is if you don't address this problem soon enough, you could run into a situation where that oil leak gets onto the crank pulley. That'll cause the serpentine belt to come off the crank pulley, and usually when that happens, the engine will literally ingest the belt. I mean, there's no other way to say that. You'll have serpentine belt shards inside your engine since it's forced past the front main seal, and then you're looking at a huge repair. So this is something that you want to address once you start seeing that kind of leak. Now that we've gotten the cowl removed, everything is exposed on the intake manifold, and we could start removing the air filter housing. Now on all the N54 cars, it's gonna be pretty much similar. You have a front and a rear suction pipe that come off the main housing. And so it's just a matter of disconnecting all the vacuum lines that are attached to it. We'll then pull the air box out of it and start disconnecting the intake manifold from the engine. We have a couple of fresh air hoses that come off the air box, and these go to the turbo. And one in the front, one in the rear, at least on this particular engine. The N54s are going to be like that because of the twin turbos. It's not going to be like that on the N55. There's like nothing metal in this fucking engine, man. It's crazy. Everything's fucking aluminum. So next step, we need to take the charge pipe out, which is right here. We have two recirculation valves that go back into the air inlets from the charge pipe. These are simply held on by these twist locks. So we'll untwist these locks, we'll take off the vacuum hose right here that goes on the back of these valves, and then we'll be able to pull these off, and then we're gonna take out our charge pipe going to the throttle body. Just like that. Just gonna pull them out entirely. Next step, we have our little quick disconnect clamp here for the charge pipe. And we also have a hose clamp here that we're gonna loosen up, and we'll be able to pull the charge pipe out of the way. The head of this clamp is a 7 mil. They're usually 6 or 7. And you see a screw style clamp on that. All right, we're gonna take the throttle body off the intake manifold just to make it easier to get to the main electrical connector under the manifold. And these are all 10 millimeter bolts. Also, just want to mention really quick, there is a vacuum piece that's connected to the throttle body. It's basically just one of these quick disconnect tabs. Connects to this little fixture on the throttle body right there. You do have an electrical connector that goes to the throttle body. Just a simple tab. There's an electrical box underneath the intake manifold that slides onto these, this metal retainer. I'm just gonna go ahead and slide this off. These can be pretty damn stubborn. If you use a little bit of silicone spray, you should be able to slide this right off. And just to make removal of the intake manifold a little easier, taking the engine cover off. This is held on with 6 millimeter hex screws, and there's 3 of them. All right, we have 7 11 millimeter fasteners holding the intake manifold of the cylinder head. 2 of them are 11 millimeter bolts, 5 of them are 11 millimeter screws, nuts, 11 millimeter nuts, sorry. We're gonna work our way down the line, and before we pull the manifold off, we're gonna go ahead and disconnect this other map sensor here. This one up front's a bolt. And this right here is just our map sensor. The one down there was the T-map sensor, temperature and manifold absolute pressure. Now we should be good to pull the intake manifold. It is pretty tight space here, so it almost needs to come out at an angle. Reach underneath, verify that nothing else is connected. We have a little valve hooked on here, which I believe is our EVAP valve. Just gonna slide that off. And then we have a little Christmas tree connector holding a electrical harness in place. So next things we need to do, we have to take this entire support off the top in order to remove the fan shroud. And also when removing the fan shroud, we need to disconnect the oil cooler lines that come down here. And to take the fan out, you need to remove this upper piece. Of course, this is only going to be a problem on the 535Xis. On pretty much any other car, you're not gonna have that issue. So this is only specific to the 535s. Disconnect the hood release. So we have our expansion tank line that comes across from our expansion tank to the upper radiator hose. Now, somebody's been in here before and this line has broken and they've put some, looks like brass or copper fittings in there. This whole thing looks extremely dangerous. So I'm gonna do my best not to disturb it too much, but I do need this out of the way. These are extremely fragile. It's most common to break at the upper radiator hose quick disconnect at the radiator. That's gonna be your stress point. We're gonna clamp down on the hose, like so. And then we're gonna pull the quick disconnect tab up. And then we're gonna gently walk this off. And if there's any pressure in here, I'm gonna release it now. There shouldn't be though. We can rest this hose gently off to the side, out of the way of danger. Just keep in mind that when we pull this whole fan out, that we don't bump this piece over here, because that will be the end of this particular component. Next, we're gonna disconnect the radiator fan electrical shroud, pull the electrical connector out of the way. And now our next move is, there's a fitting here for the oil cooler itself. It goes through the fan shroud. So to pull the fan off, you have to disconnect these lines. There's no way around it. All right, we have a 6 millimeter Allen here that secures the oil cooler line the attempt to make some room here. We're gonna use pinch off pliers on this hose as well. Hold back any oil that's gonna come out of it. We're definitely gonna have some oil that comes out over here. These are T25s and we're removing them to gain access to the fan in order to remove the fan. All right, so our next step here is we need to remove the serpentine belt. To remove the serpentine belt, we have to remove this air inlet tube that goes to the turbo. There are two T27 screws that hold that inlet tube to the front of the engine. So we're gonna go ahead and remove those now. We have another connector down here that's holding a bunch of hoses to this inlet pipe. It's an E8 screw, so we're gonna remove that. So to make removal of everything a little bit cleaner, to take the oil filter housing cover off, or the oil filter housing cap, and we're gonna siphon out some of the oil that's in the housing. So we start taking it apart, we're gonna have a bunch of oil and coolant go everywhere. So just trying to remove any potential mess doing this right here. And we're just gonna siphon some of this oil out of here. Oh, hey, I didn't see you there. All right, so back underneath the vehicle, to mitigate the mess, once we start disconnecting the oil cooler and the oil filter housing, we're gonna drain the coolant out of the radiator, which is going to allow us to remove the upper radiator hose and the oil cooler without having to risk coolant going everywhere, getting on the belt. We're gonna remove the lower charge pipe from the intercooler, which will then give us access to the drain plug, the radiator, which is right up here. We have the radiator drain plug down there. I'll go ahead and remove it. So the radiator is drained out. We no longer have any antifreeze in this upper radiator hose. So I'm just gonna go ahead and put the drain plug for the radiator back in. It does have to be clocked in a certain orientation. So if it's not going all the way in, don't force it. Just keep maneuvering it around until it finally seats, and then you should be able to thread it in without any problems. So first thing we're gonna do is disconnect the upper radiator hose. This has a quick disconnect fitting on it. I'm just gonna go ahead and use a pick to get underneath the clip that secures it. Like so. Now we did drain the coolant, but I just want to make sure there's not going to be any residual that comes off when I pull it. It's all right. Perfect. All right, now we have three E10 bolts that hold the oil filter housing to the cylinder head. You have this guy back here. Right here, which is hidden by the intake manifold, which is why the intake manifold has to come off on this car. If you have the naturally aspirated six cylinder, you don't have to do that. You have another one here, and then you have another one back here, but I'm gonna get that one last. So my recommendation for this bolt right here, you can see a very little room. I do not want to disconnect this hose because these fittings are prone to breaking. I have a special E10 ratcheting wrench here from Gear Wrench. You really need something like this to break that fastener free. Will make removal way easier than if you don't have it. And then once it's loose, you could probably come in with a regular 12-point ratcheting wrench and you'll be fine. But you really would need something like this to gain access to that bolt to break it free. All right, now we're gonna go ahead and then pull the housing out. All right, so as you can see, this is the side of the cylinder head. That's what the oil filter housing connects to. But if you look underneath here, some of this is obviously spilled out once we broke the seal. But to a degree, you can kind of see some areas here, some lighter areas where the gasket was not firmly pressed up against the cylinder head. And that's where the leak generates. And as you can kind of see, it comes down behind the alternator bracket there. All right, so we have our oil filter housing, oil cooler thermostat, and our oil cooler hoses off the car. First thing we're gonna do, because I really wanna clean up the this mess. I mean, you can really see how wet this is underneath. So it looks to me like the oil cooler thermostat gasket has been leaking. And I also know that the oil filter housing has been leaking. So I really gotta separate these two pieces. To number one, clean them. Number two, to replace those seals. All right, so the oil cooler line bracket, that's a 6mm hex. I'm just gonna make sure that hex is actually seated. There's a lot of crud in that, so you can strip it off if you don't properly seat it. And it shouldn't be that tight, so. And then we'll go ahead and just pull these lines out. So our oil cooler thermostat is held on with three E12 bolts. These are all the same. Just gonna go ahead and remove those now. All right, so there might be some residual oil that's gonna come out of the oil cooler thermostat, so just be prepared for that. Have towels, rags. There's the oil cooler thermostat gasket right there. And if I look on this piece, which is the thermostat, I can kind of see some areas that have been kind of wiped clean. So it's most likely where the oil leak originated from. All right, so we have these two pieces separated from one another. Like I said, oil's still gonna leak out. We'll go ahead and clean these guys down with some brake parts cleaner, some brushes. Really nothing crazy you have to worry about when you're cleaning these out. Nothing that's too sensitive here. So really just go ahead and get them cleaned and we'll go ahead and start placing the gaskets, putting this assembly back together and getting it back in the car. We've gone ahead and cleaned both the oil cooler thermostat up and the oil filter housing. We've removed as much of the loose debris as we could. We use a small pick here to remove the gaskets. Now these are pretty compressed, they're pretty hard, so they might be a little bit of a pain to remove, but just peel them out. And if these are in really bad shape, they'll probably break as they come out, but you can go ahead and just pick off the broken pieces. But you do want to make sure that all of the gasket material is removed before you install the new ones. Otherwise, you'll have a massive oil leak. Here are the gaskets that we took off. If we were to do a side-by-side comparison, you could see that the old gasket right here has been pretty flattened out. First thing we're gonna do is install the gasket for the oil cooler thermostat, and we're gonna put the oil cooler thermostat back on. These were the E12 bolts. They're all the same size and the same length, so there isn't any special orientation that you need to worry about when you're installing. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and torque these three bolts to 18 newton meters. Like I said, these are aluminum and they are cast, so while you can basically squeeze that gasket pretty well on your own, I do recommend going with the manufacturer specs on this and using a torque wrench just to play it safe. Because if you were to break either one of these pieces, they're not cheap to replace. All right, next, we're gonna replace the oil cooler line O-rings. Now there's two different O-rings here. You have a thicker O-ring on the other end that goes into the oil cooler. And then you have this tiny O-ring that just kind of slips on at the oil cooler thermostat. I do recommend replacing both of these, even if they are in good shape. So these are pretty cheap. No reason to cheap out and not replace these, in my opinion. This is cheap insurance. And when you're slipping these O-rings on, I say use a little bit of oil just to lubricate them. It's obviously gonna be oil left over on these oil cooler lines, so no problem with that. but the oil will help them seal, which is ultimately what you want. All right, next up here, we're gonna go ahead and reinstall our oil cooler lines. Now, one of these oil cooler lines has a mounting tab on it. The other one doesn't, but that's fine. They just slip together. We're gonna do this now versus when the oil filter housing is back on the car, only because we have better access to the hex cap screw that holds it in place. Now, obviously these lines are different sizes and different shapes. How do you know which one goes where? Well, obviously this filter housing is located on the left side of the engine or closer to the driver's side. That's gonna have the shorter hose connected to it facing this way. Longer hose is gonna go towards the passenger side or the right side. And the short side will always go, at least on this car, on the upper radiator hose fitting on the oil filter housing. Now it's a 6mm hex cap screw, or it's a 6mm drive. We're gonna go ahead and install this retainer screw to keep it in place. There is no torque spec for this retainer screw in TIS. So just using some common sense here, again, you are threading into a cast aluminum housing. The O-rings are actually on the outside here. All you're looking to do is compress those O-rings slightly, and that's what's gonna give you your leak-free seal. So really, once this bolt tightens up, I'm using a quarter inch drive here so you can't over torque it. You're done, don't go any further. We're good. All right, so at this point, we're gonna put the oil filter housing gasket. This seals the oil filter housing to the cylinder head. Now, there is no orientation the way that this gasket is installed, same on both sides. All you really wanna do is make sure that it is pressed in. And like I said earlier, these nubs that they have added to the newer style gasket, they're going to hold this gasket in place for you. So, you know, once you get it in the groove, you're pretty much ready to install this thing. So we have our entire assembly here. We're gonna go ahead and reinstall it to the cylinder head. Obviously make sure the sealing surface here is cleaned. Now my recommendation is to take the lower screw, the one that goes down here, and get that started first. Since this is gonna be the most difficult one to get, and you really wanna make sure that it's threading into the lower portion of the housing first. Yeah, I really wanna get this started by hand first. And since this one obviously has the least amount of space to work with, just wanna draw the bolt in. And now that we have some engagement of the threads and we've moved it in a little bit, I'm just gonna go ahead and take a ratcheting wrench here. Now I'm not gonna make this 100% tight yet because I obviously have to put the other bolts in. I wanna evenly compress the gasket. And I'm using a 12 point on this E-Torx for this. You can do that for threading it. I wouldn't use a 12 point to tighten because you can round it off. We'll use a E-Torx wrench for that when we get to that point. The oil filter housing has three bolt sizes. I've just threaded in the shortest one. The shortest one's gonna be in the front. Now you have a long one and you have a medium sized one. The long one is gonna go in the top since that's the largest or longest length that you're gonna look at. And the medium length one goes in the rear here. I'm just gonna go ahead and get those started by hand. And I don't fully tighten any of these bolts until we really start drawing this in. Reason being is, again, I wanna compress that gasket as evenly as possible so that it seals as good as possible. Again, the housing is cast aluminum, the cylinder head is aluminum. If the bolt for some reason is threading awkwardly or not correctly, you want to be able to feel it. I'm going to go ahead and get this front bolt, draw that in a little bit more. And you'll start to feel these bolts get tight. But you do want to run over them a couple times because as that gasket settles, the previous bolts that were tight before may not be tight anymore. And we will get these torqued to spec, at least these top two. This one behind here is kind of impossible to do that on, but we'll at least feel it and how tight it should be based on those other bolts. Torque spec on these oil filter housing bolts is 22 newton meters. I think we're pretty close. Just gonna go nice and smooth with the torque wrench. That's 22. That's 22. I'm gonna go ahead and hand tighten that front bolt. I have a pretty good feel for how tight this should be. We're properly torqued. And now we can go ahead and start reconnecting some of our hoses and things, putting our fan back in. Those are the next steps. And I'm just gonna put the filter housing cap back on. We are gonna put a new filter and do an oil change on this car, but just to make sure that nothing drops in there and goes in the engine. I'm just gonna thread this back on for now. Next step, we're gonna go ahead and reinstall our auxiliary fan and engine oil cooler back in place. Really just wanna make sure that all of your hoses are out of the way and you're not gonna get anything trapped going down. First, let's get our oil cooler hoses in place. Now we have a brand new O-ring on those, and they are lubricated with some oil, so it should slip into place pretty easily. You'll hear them kind of click in, and take your retaining screws and thread those back on. Definitely want to do that, otherwise you'll have oil all over the place and you don't want that. Also, look this up in BMW TIS. There is no listed torque spec for these specifically, at least on this 535, but these are 6mm hex cap screws. I'm using quarter inch drive here. Once the screw is tight, don't go any further. You do not need to kill these to keep the hose in place. So before you put this upper radiator hose back on, inspect the O-ring inside. There's an O-ring that seals this coupler to the fitting on the oil filter housing. Most BMW coolant hoses are like that. My recommendation is to take some antifreeze and lubricate the O-ring before reinstalling. That will prevent the O-ring from binding and it'll help it slide into place a little bit easier. Obviously have this retaining tab pushed in place and then just slide it on. Now this hose is keyway'd, so it's only gonna go on one way. And once it's seated 100%, drop the ring in place, the snap connect, and you're good, you're reinstalled. All right, next step, just plug in the auxiliary fan, which is a big connector here. It should come up from behind the oil cooler lines and the refrigerant lines for the AC compressor. All right, next we have this, probably call it like a cooling module encasing. This basically holds the fan, the radiator, the AC condenser, this whole upper piece. It holds it to the support and it clips together. I'm just gonna go ahead and reinstall this. The front portion goes under and the rearward portion goes over and it kind of clips into place. And then we have five torque screws that hold it together. Sorry, retraction. Those are T25s, not T27s. One of these has been previously rounded for us, so. All right, we've gone ahead and installed all of those T25s. Remember, there's five of them. You know, this expansion tank hose has been modified with this centerpiece. Do not want to replace this hose. Normally, it will clip into these channels here. However, when we took it apart, it was held together with zip ties. So we're just gonna go ahead and zip tie this hose back together so it just stays in place and we don't run into any problems later on. All right, we're gonna go ahead and reinstall our upper radiator support here. This has our hood release levers and the hood release lever cable, which needs to be reconnected over there. But this pretty much just lays into place. It will fall into place on its own, so don't force it. And we're gonna go ahead and reconnect our hood release cable. I'll close that. All right, we're gonna go ahead and reinstall our upper radiator support. We've hooked up our hood release cables. So all we have to do is just reinstall these T30 torque screws. And there's witness marks from where this was before. So we're just gonna go ahead and line this up as close as we can to where it was before, because obviously that's going to align with the hood catches. So now we're ready to reinstall the intake manifold. We're gonna go ahead and replace the intake manifold gaskets, which are basically just these little guys right here. I recommend replacing them because they do get brittle over time. And failure to do so, if this intake manifold doesn't properly seal on your turbo applications, you'll have small boost leak. These gaskets are easy to install. They just kind of slip into place. So, and they're relatively inexpensive. So to go through all this work to have a problem result because of a failure to replace a basic gasket, it's really not worth the savings in my opinion. It's just easier to go ahead and just replace them. All right, let's shove her back in. It's a pretty tight fit. What we want to do is not to bend any of the studs. And we also want to make sure that we don't get any vacuum hoses or electrical connectors stuck behind this, because obviously when you go to tighten this down, that's going to cause some problems later on. So just make sure everything's out of the way and just get it in there. Remember that there are 7 fasteners to hold the intake manifold to the cylinder head. There's 6 nuts, 6 studs, and a bolt. A bolt is going to go in the front. Just gonna get these nuts threaded on. And then we'll torque the intake manifold down. And then this is our bolt that goes towards the front. While we're at it, we're just gonna go ahead and plug the MAP sensor in on the intake manifold, since the harness is right there. And then down here, we have our electrical box. We're gonna slide that back onto this bracket. Should just clip into place. Start tightening some of these intake manifold nuts down. All right, we have our oil pressure switch here on the oil filter housing. Plug that in. We have our EVAP purge valve, which is back here. We're just gonna slide it back onto the bracket. We're gonna go ahead and torque all of the fasteners for the intake manifold. These get torqued to 15 newton meters. And I like to start in the middle and work my way out. All right, so the next step is we're gonna go ahead and reinstall the throttle body. And before reinstalling the throttle body, make sure that you replace the throttle body gasket. All right, next step, we replace that gasket. So we're gonna go ahead and install the throttle body. Remember, we do have a vacuum line that connects to the throttle body, so I'd recommend getting that in first. Should just push into place. You'll hear it clip. And then we also have the electrical connector for this. Can only go on one way. It is keyed, so you don't have to worry about that. Right now I'm just drawing these bolts in evenly, and then once I have them in and throttle body seated against the intake manifold. All right, we're gonna go ahead and torque the throttle body to the intake manifold. Torque spec is 8 newton meters. Again, just making sure that we're properly compressing that gasket. Next, we're gonna go ahead and install the charge pipe. This is the piece that connects the throttle body to the lower intercooler pipe. I'm gonna make sure that we get it over the charge pipe first. You'll kind of feel it bump into place. Perfect. Yeah, sometimes it helps to take that clip out. It'll help seat it a little bit better. Next, we have our T-MAP sensor on the charge pipe. We're gonna go ahead and plug that connector in, which is right behind here at the throttle body. We already have one recirculation valve in. We're gonna go ahead and lock it in place. Locked in place. This is our forward piece, forward recirculating valve. Again, I'm just gonna go ahead and seat it in the charge pipe, seat it in the inlet tube. And again, these are twist locks, so just gonna twist lock them in place. We have our vacuum hose here. One side connects to the intake manifold, and then the other side goes to our diverter valves. I'm gonna make sure we get that installed properly. There's only one orientation for this. So the curved ends of the vacuum hose are always going to face our diverter valves, and then we have a nipple on the back side of the intake manifold that it pretty much just plugs into. And then before securing the air filter housing and everything like that, we're gonna go ahead and just tighten down our charge pipe clamp. All right, next step, we're gonna go install the lower portion of our air box. So basically gonna slip this into position. Best piece of advice for getting this in, just a couple of grommets on top. Get that pressed in first, and then you can reach from behind and walk the inlet pipe for the rear turbo in place. Just make sure the one in the front is properly seated. And then once you have that done, go ahead and rehook the harnesses to the side of the air box. And you should just slip into place. Vacuum hose here, this is from your brake, or this goes to your brake booster from your vacuum pump. So you have a couple clips on the side of the air box. Go ahead and secure those in place, and then go ahead and clip. Now we'll go ahead and tighten down the hose clamps that hold the turbo inlet tubes to the air box, and then we'll go ahead and install the rest of the air filter housing. Yeah. Lost for words, man. We're gonna go ahead and take our 6mm driver here. If you also have a 6mm clamp driver, that would also work. You're not looking to kill these, you're just looking to keep it tight. There's no pressure on these, so nothing crazy. Here's our fresh air scoop for the air filter housing. We're gonna go ahead and slide this back into place. All right, we have a self-expanding rivet. Just push that into place, and that'll hold our fresh air intake for the air box in place. And then last, but certainly not least, because we have other stuff to do on this car, reinstall the air filter. So we're gonna most likely replace. Go ahead and reinstall the cover, which goes, no, it's the right way. Ta-da! And that's pretty much the entire process to replace the oil filter housing gasket and the oil cooler thermostat seal on an N54 engine. Like we kind of talked about before, this process is going to be varying on an N54 and N55 in terms of how you have to deal with the oil cooler and the oil cooler thermostat. On an N51 or N52 powered car, obviously you don't need to remove the intake manifold, so that job is significantly easier. But you know, this car is the hardest to do this job on, so you've seen it as the worst possible scenario. Hope you learned something. If you have any comments or questions, leave it in the box below, and we'll see you for the next one. Really? Really? Wow. I've never seen that before. That's